जी नमस्कार, आई एम फ्रॉम वॉशिंगटन डीसी एंड आई एम वेरी डिलाइटेड टू कनेक्ट एंड स्पीक टू ऑल ऑफ यू इन दिस वर्चुअल इंटरनेशनल कॉन्फ्रेंस ऑफ माय अल्मा मैटर आईसीआई. फ्रेंड्स, वी ऑल हर्ड द ऑनरेबल फाइनेंस मिनिस्टर निर्मला सीतारामन जी ऑन द अदर डे प्रॉमिसिंग ए वाइब्रेंट बजट 2021 व्हिच विल टेक केयर ऑफ ए sustainable revival of the economy. This is a very good news, and India is not alone. World over, countries are grappling with this challenge of moving out of the pandemic and making progress for sustainable and inclusive growth. The theme of my talk is essentially the need for a triangulation. The triangulation between three key players, economists, accountants, and policymakers for inclusive economic growth. At a technical level, it simply means a happy marriage between economists and accountants. Sounds difficult? Let's try to make it possible. Let me set the context a bit. I work as the head of PIFA Secretariat. PIFA is the public expenditure and financial accountability framework. It's the gold standard for public financial management used in several countries. It's an initiative of 9 development partners housed in the World Bank. What we do in maintaining this framework is to help governments assess their own budget processes. Are the budgets reliable? Is there transparency in government financing in the country? How do governments manage their assets and liabilities? Are budgets based on policies? Is there predictability and control of budget execution? How is accounting auditing? So these are the kinds of issues that we talk about when we talk of public financial management. And with three goals, ensure fiscal discipline, efficient resource allocation, and efficient service delivery. PIFA has been used in over in 153 countries so far, 653 assessments world over. Right now, an assessment is in progress in the state of Himachal Pradesh in India. So what's how does it connect to public finance? So governments use public finance through two means to support inclusive and sustainable growth. One, the use of taxation. Two, public spending. These two are the twin factors which influence sustainable and inclusive growth. Success of government is in this, its ability to spend responsibly, tax fairly, and efficiently. So how has governments been doing over a period of time globally? If you take the pre-COVID-19 era, generally from 2005, since PIFA assessments have been conducted globally, there is an trend of improvements in various PIFA scores. In PIFA, we score on various parameters on D to A, D being the lowest score and A being highest. And each Ministry of Finance, each government wants to move from D to A on various parameters. So this overall storyline is of progress. Things are improving globally, both at an aggregate level and on median scores levels. So this is good news. And is it going across the board for all the parameters or for few aspects of budget? I would say that it's generally across the board. So on all the parameters, world has seen progress before COVID-19. So there are still some laggards. For example, accounting reporting and financial reporting hasn't made the progress as much as some other parameters. For example, policy-based budgeting or predictability and control of execution is so, which means there are activities which are in progress. So world has been making progress, but then COVID came and things changed. As you know, COVID has changed everything. COVID has moved more than 88 million people into extreme poverty in just these few months. And the World Bank poverty numbers project that it could go even up to anything between 110 to 150 million by 2021, which means these additional people are going to live at less than $1.9 per day, which is serious. Then we have economies. Never in the past have simultaneously so many economies gone into recession since 1870. The downgrades to growth have been the steepest and the fastest amongst all recessions since 1990. Yes, sounds tricky, and balance sheets are affected, government balance sheets. So there are revenues which are coming down, expenditure which is still going up. Now, which practically means the government net worth as a percentage GDP is taking a beating. So the projections in this chart show that some of the economies by 2022, they are going to have serious impact on the ratio of net worth to GDP. So what's happening to the nuts and bolts and basics of public financial management? So COVID-19 has also impacted them. Budgets are changing at dramatic pace. So there's nothing like an annual budget you're sticking to. You're making decisions on a day-to-day basis. Borrowings are improving. We accountants and auditors talk of traditionally controls and control mechanisms, and the traditional PFM systems are modified world over. They are diluted in cases, in some cases never modified, but that just not followed. Special funds are being created outside the budget for meeting the emergency needs for good reasons, but all obviously creating challenges on public financial management front. Use and abuse of emergency procedures are being reported world over. Particularly in developing countries, you see significant risk, increased risk of fraud and corruption. These are creating opportunities and vulnerabilities. Markets failed at least in the initial days of COVID-19, and the risk of governments going ahead with single source procurements at abnormal prices is taking place very often in many developing countries. So what can be done? Let me talk about a few aspects. We need to focus on human capital. We need to focus on social sectors. Health, education, social protection needs to be priority in the for equitable and sustainable growth to make it inclusive. So this chart tells you that pre-COVID days itself, whenever a budget in a country is cut, the cut is significantly higher in sectors like health and education. Whenever the budget grows up, if government is able to spend more because it's collected more taxes, the money is not actually going to the social sectors. This prioritization of health and education is not significant. The out-of-pocket expenditures that that countries are seeing is so significant that people are bearing in many of the developing countries. So this is one area which we need to focus upon. There need to be stronger alignment between sector ministries and the Ministry of Finance. They often don't talk the same language. They should understand from the same perspectives that Ministry of Finance says spend better, and whereas sector ministry says give me more money for me to deliver resources. How do we fix this? There are demands like the earmarking taxes, like sin taxes, tobacco tax, or alcohol tax. Do we tax earmark those funding for health sector? Does it really work? So these are the areas where common thinking is required. Short-termism is a problem. So all actions of government need to be aligned to a national plan and a medium-term expenditure framework, and sector strategies and budgets linked to that. Often a weakness in many, many emerging economies in developing countries. We need to stop talking about how much money is budgeted and how much is spent. That's what we talk when we hear of budget. We need to talk of what money buys and what change it made. Program budgeting could be a means to help that kind of an approach. Public financial management systems need to balance between control and flexibility to give the kind of a required pace of flow of money to sectors. Money can save lives in critical times like this. Let me talk about balance sheets. But does governments really have balance sheets? If they do they talk to policymakers? So let me pick up the item of debt. $60 trillion globally is the dollar is the debt scale right now, and is it captured in government balance sheets? Often not. Fundamental problems. Government balance sheets still are in many countries on cash basis. The debt we talk of is a statistical number. There's no accounting standard to base on it. There is no assessment of reasonableness of the debt taking place. And even where debt is being reported, you have all these debts of state-owned enterprises. Public sector undertakings, the way we call them in India, if they engage debt, that's not counted and not taken into consideration in overall government debt. So the whole question of financial statements giving better quality messaging to policymakers becomes extremely important. And migration to cash to accrual account basis accounting is long overdue. We talked about it for more than a decade now. The progress hasn't been very strong globally. Many countries need to accelerate the pace. Ipsos accrual provides solid framework to do an accrual basis accounting. For example, in India, there are the foundations already laid with the government Government Accounting Standards Advisory Board in for the country working on this agenda. We need a scenario where a whole of government financial statements are available. Typically, for example, in India, the central government and all the states, everything to putting together, getting the bigger picture for policymakers to make the right kind of policy actions. Control agencies are reorienting. The independence of supreme auditing institutions needs to be strong and effectively maintained. SAIs need to focus on performance audits and probably cooperative and participatory audits involving civil society organizations could be a game changer for inclusive growth policy making by the governments. We can't talk of inclusive growth without talking about gender, and gender has never been really taken very seriously in public finances over decades. It's only now that we are now talking a lot about it. PIFA has recently issued something called a PIFA gender to help governments work on public financial management with a gender lens. We have a very small sample of assessments based on gender, but from that, what we see as trends as gender impact assessments are done before a policy is made in some countries, but those are more relating to expenditure aspects. Revenue aspects are not looked upon with a gender lens very often. Whenever a major project is taken care of, is implemented, a feasibility study, only in half of the countries that we reviewed that we see that gender impact analysis is part of it. For an inclusive growth, gender needs to be taken care of. Sex disaggregated data as a part of line ministries collecting information takes place, but this is not used for performance measurement, a kind of a disconnect. Legislatures, the parliaments, the assemblies, they don't, in various countries, they don't really scrutinize gender impact as significantly as they should have. On the same lines, we also have implemented something called a PIFA, the Climate Responsive Public Finances PIFA framework. This is a very new product to help governments in doing having the climate lens to see how climate-related expenditure is being managed and monitored by governments. All these assessments are driven essentially by the ministries of finance. These are country-led, the government-led. The role of PIFA Secretariat is essentially to provide quality assurance, and we issue what is called a PIFA check certification to say that the assessment followed a kind of a standard good practice expected from the PIFA Secretariat perspective. So in conclusion, I would actually also mention a couple of quick things. We are going to launch the first ever global report on public financial management in February. So far, the data of PIFA reports, of the public financial management reports, which are externally published, the government decides whether a report will be public or internal. So all the published reports are available with us in the Secretariat, used for research purposes. We are now putting it out in a highly dynamic online navigable platform, which will be released in February. You can go through the global trends, regional trends, country or theme interests, and I hope you'll have time sometime to take a look at it when it comes through. In summary, the game for the future, as we think of the blue sky thinking into the future of government, public financial management and public finances play an extremely important role, and the role of accountants and economists working together is key. The Institute of Chartered Accountants of India has been doing tremendous job and pioneering effort in collaborating with various agencies within the government. And it's time to scale up the impact. The future is ours, the accountants, and we need to scale up what we are doing. The PIFA Secretariat would be glad to collaborate with all of you. More information is available on the on PIFA.org, the PIFA, the partnership of 9 development partners, including the World Bank, IMF, European Commission, and several other bilaterals. Very glad to talk to you on this occasion. All the very best. Jai Hind.
Thank you, Srinivas ji. Just like a Ganges flowing in the last 15 minutes, you covered the entire thing of public finance, start with how the economic and accountants and policymakers, there should be a coordination and wedlock, how the importance of double entry system of accounting in government bodies, and what India has started doing on this issue, what is the drawbacks of cash accounting, what is the importance of balance sheet in government systems, and what is the reporting you talked about, the public expenditure financial accountability, which is most useful for the members and the professional institution. Thank you for contribution. I request Satish Gupta ji to introduce our Bhishma Pitamaka of India.